بسم الله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم I begin in the name of the Almighty God, the Compassionate, the Merciful, the One who has created everything in utmost perfection. And may the peace and blessings of the Almighty God be upon the best of His creation, the peak of humanity, The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And his immaculate progeny of the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, especially the leader of our time, the awaited Savior, al-Imam al-Mahdi ajjalallahu ta'ala farajah. May God hasten his reappearance. And make us all amongst his sincere and dedicated servants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. Every soul shall taste death. Sadaqallahu al-Aliyyul Azim. Illuminate your hearts and minds with a very loud salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Before we came into this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created our soul. Before our physical bodies, we had a prior existence. When God created the soul of all human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala programmed the soul to recognize Him. In one verse in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us that He made His existence manifest to us. قَالَ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ Am I not your Lord? What did everyone say in that prior existence? قَالُوا بَلَى Yes, we recognize that you are our Lord. The Almighty God has programmed us to believe in Him. It's our society that changes and corrupts this fitrah, this innate nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has programmed in us. Scientists till this very day, they're baffled. Even evolutionary scientists. Why is it that human beings are programmed to believe in a supernatural power, in a higher being? Because the Almighty God has programmed us. Many scholars believe that the intellect which we have, we can decide right from wrong. How do we know this? When was this programmed in us? It was programmed in our soul before we came to this life. For example, we all know that 1 + 1 = 2. How do we know that? Because the brain is what? Scientifically, biologically, when you examine the brain, it's simply what? A bunch of chemical reactions. Neurons connecting with each other. That power to perceive and understand, where does it come from? Scholars believe that comes from the soul. When the Almighty God programmed the soul. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attached the soul to the body, and in essence, the Almighty God imprisoned the soul in the body. Our souls are trapped in these materialistic bodies when we came to this world, when we came to this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us an opportunity in this life, to strengthen the soul, to empower the soul, and to purify the soul. God is not only testing us in this life, but the Almighty God is giving us an opportunity to elevate the soul. Now the connection, the link between us and our soul is what in this life? It's the intellect, it's the mind, it's let's call it the brain that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. That's our connection. Through this body, we interact with the soul. You know, people who are mentally challenged, by the way, insane people, people with mental deformities, they have a problem in their brain, but not in their soul. Their soul is completely fine. It's intact. They have no issue with their soul. The only problem is that the connection between their brain and the soul is weakened. It's a weaker connection. Otherwise, their soul is perfectly fine. And hence, people who are mentally challenged, either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will retest them after they die, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them and take them directly to paradise without any test. Because they didn't corrupt their soul. They died pure people who did not contaminate their soul. That is why a mentally challenged person can actually be better than a sinful person, than a corrupt person, than an evil human being. Because an evil human being has corrupted his soul, contaminated his soul. But a mentally challenged person has not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly takes that person to paradise. See how sometimes even the human being makes himself at a worse position than a mentally challenged person. We think we're all good and better than people with disabilities. No, Habibi. Sometimes someone with a mental disability can be better than you. Because that person has not contaminated his or her soul, but you have. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trapped our souls in this physical body. We came to this life, we complete our trial, our test, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes our soul back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the soul from this body. He separates the soul from this physical body. And that's what we call death. What is death? Death really is just a transition, moving from one stage to another stage. That's what death is. And this is a very important transition for us, respected brothers and sisters. When you examine the body of ahadith that we have, the verses in the Holy Quran, most verses in the Holy Quran are reminding us of this imminent transition that we all will be experiencing. I know some people, they don't like to talk about death. They don't like to hear about death. But in reality, when you speak about death, when you think of death, you're not really thinking of death. You're thinking of life. Because the Holy Quran tells us that death is in reality life. What does the Quran say? وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ The true life is where? The akhirah, the hereafter, the afterlife. That's the true life. In another verse, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala captures the state of the sinful one, the unbeliever, who will have so much regret, what will he say on the day of judgment? يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي قَدَّمْتُ لِحَيَاتِي I wish I would have been more prepared for my life, for the real life, because the real life is on the day of judgment. So when we talk about death, we are actually discussing life. And that should not spook anyone. That should not discourage anyone or disinterest anyone. Because you're talking about life, the real life. This life is nothing but a transition. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam says, إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا دَارُ مَمَرُ The world is what? It's a bridge. It's just simply a passageway. وَإِنَّ الْآخِرَةَ دَارُ مَقَرُ And the real abode, the real life is where? The akhirah. That's the real life. Therefore, the Imam says, be prepared. Take from this life for the hereafter. This life is a bridge. Treat it like a bridge. Have you seen someone building a house on a bridge? No. Because a bridge is what? It's supposed to connect you from one point to another point. That's what life is. In one beautiful narration, the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, he was seen sleeping on a coarse pillow. It wasn't really a pillow. It was a coarse straw mat. Some companions told him, "Oh, messenger of God, how come you're not like the kings? You're not like Caesar." Caesar was a reference for the kings. "We don't see any king who sleeps on such a coarse piece of fabric or coarse object." The Prophet, peace be upon him, he told them, "Look, why should I do that? I'm not a king. I'm just a humble servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My goal is not to achieve comfort in this life. My goal is not to pursue a comfortable pillow when I sleep." Now remember, back then it was a luxury for someone to have a fancy, comfortable pillow. Now it's common. Then the Prophet says, "You know what life is? It's like a traveler who's traveling in the middle of the desert, and then he gets tired. He wants some shade. He comes to seek some shade under a tree, and then he moves on." That's what life is. That's what it is. It's just a transition point. Al-Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, on the day of Ashura, when he saw death racing to his companions and family members, some of them initially were shaken. And Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, what did he tell them? He said, "Sabran bani al-kiram," have patience, my beloved sons, the beloved sons of the generous ones, have patience. "Famal mawtu illa qantara," believe me that death is nothing but a bridge. "Ta'bur bikum min al-bu's wal-dharra ila al-jinan al-wasi'." It's a bridge that takes you from misery to the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to open gardens, "wan-na'im ad-da'ima," and eternal bliss. "Fa'ayyukum yakrah an yantaqila min sijnin ila qasr." Is there a human being who does not desire to move out from a prison and go and settle in a palace? You're going to a palace. So have patience. This world is just a temporary transition point. When we talk about death and the akhirah, we're talking about the real permanent life. That's why it's so recommended in the religion of Islam to constantly think about death, because thinking about death keeps us prepared. It always keeps us in check to do that which is right. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, would constantly urge his companions, think of death, the death which will end the worldly pleasures for us, death which will end our gatherings in this life. It really gives life to our hearts. In one amazing hadith, the Prophet says, one of the best forms of ibadah, one of the best acts of worship is to what? To remember death. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, in one hadith says, if you remember death 20 times a day, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect you with the shuhada, with the martyrs. 20 times a day. When you think of death 20 times a day, you think you will commit those sins. You'll backbite, you'll watch that haram film or movie or scene. Listen to music, harass your parents, be untruthful to others in society. You think you'll do that if you really think about death 20 times a day? It really keeps us in check. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect us with the martyrs. Now why is it that we despise death? Why do we hate death? In one hadith, Al-Imam Al-Jawad alayhi salam, he says the reason why we despise death or hate death is because we are ignorant of it. We have no clue what death is and what death represents. That's why we hate it. It's very natural. Otherwise, if you know what death is, and you've kept yourself prepared for death, then you should be willing to embrace it when it comes to you. And then he gives a beautiful analogy. This analogy is by Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. He says, for the believer, death is like removing, taking off dirty clothes and putting on new, fancy, wonderful clothes. And for the unbeliever, to the contrary, death is like removing fancy clothes and putting on dirty clothes. But the Imam says, for the believers, you should look forward to it. Don't be afraid of it. But the reason why we're afraid of it is because of our sins. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, in one hadith, what does he say? يَكْرَهُ الْمَوْتَ لِكَثْرَةِ ذُنُوبِ. People hate death because of their sins. And what do they do? وَيُقِيمُ عَلَى مَا يَكْرَهُ الْمَوْتُ لَهُ مَوْتَ لَهُ SubhanAllah. The Imam says they hate death, people hate death, because of their sins. And they continue to do that which makes them hate death, which is continuing to sin. But if we really understand what death is, and we keep ourselves prepared for it, we will have no issues. Death is actually what will give us life when we go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when the moment of death comes, who takes our soul? One day a man came to Al-Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. He told him, there is a contradiction in the Quran. The Imam says, how? Why? Why do you say that? He said, because there is one verse that says, Allahu yatawaffa al-anfusa hina mawtaha. God is the one who takes your souls at the moment of death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes our souls. And you know, interestingly, every night when you sleep, you know what the hadith says? And this is not to spook you. This is in the Quran. Every night when you sleep, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually taking your soul. The soul is not completely separated from the body, but it's partially separated. Even till this very day, scientists are puzzled at sleeping and dreams. They can't explain it. Science cannot explain what happens when we sleep, why we sleep, and why we dream. It's unknown to them. When we sleep, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes our soul. Then if the moment of death has come, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply keeps the soul, does not allow the soul to return to the body. But if this person's time has not come up yet, has not expired yet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows the soul to go back to the body. So when we sleep, the soul doesn't fully exit the body. There is just a weaker link between the soul and the body. So this verse says Allah is the one who takes the soul at the moment of death or when we sleep. And then another verse says what? قُلْ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي وُكِّرَ بِكُمْ. Say that the angel of death is the one who will take your soul. Yet a third verse states what? تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Those people whose lives, whose souls are taken by the angels. So this man came to Imam Ali alayhi salam, and he told him there's a contradiction here. One verse says God takes your soul. Another verse says the angel of death. A third verse says the angels. Another verse says tawaffathu rusuluna, our messengers, meaning the angels, they take the soul. So which is it? The Imam alayhi salam beautifully described it for him. For most people, death begins with the angels taking their souls. This is for most people. Before the angel of death comes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dispatches angels to take the soul. That's because you have millions and probably billions of angels working under the angel of death. They are his aides. Many people wonder, you know, when there is an explosion or a nuclear bomb and 80,000 people die instantly, how does the angel of death take their soul? He's got 80,000 angels assisting him. For most people, the angels come to take their soul. They prepare the process of separating the soul from the body. Then once they're about to finish taking the soul, they hand over the soul to the angel of death. The angel of death takes it and he hands the soul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He submits the souls to the Almighty God. So for most people, it's just angels taking their soul. Then for special people, who are the special people? Special believers, and there are those who are particularly evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not send the angels to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the angel of death. He goes to them. For special believers and for those who are extremely evil, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dispatches the angel of death to take their soul. Once the Prophet, peace be upon him, on his trip or journey to the ascension, Al-Mi'raj, he saw the angel of death. He asked him, "Oh, angel of death, how do you take the souls of people?" And the angel of death describes how he takes the soul. He says, "I have a list, a long list, and the names of all people are mentioned in this list. When the time for one of those human beings comes up, expires, I see that the name of this person is erased from the list. I realize that the time has come. I have to now take the soul. So I simply command the soul to come to me, and the soul comes." That's how. And then he explains to the Prophet, he says, "The world is like a coin in my hand." You take a coin, you know how you flip the coin in the palm of your hand? The angel of death says, "The entire world is simply like a coin in my hand." One hadith says like a tablet which has light that I look in the palm of my hand. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows me where I need to go to take that soul. And then the angel of death in this hadith, he tells the Prophet, peace be upon him, "And I visit every house 5 times a day. Do you know that our homes are visited by the angel of death 5 times a day? One hadith explains what times. During the times of salah, between 6 and 7 a.m. every day, the angel of death is visiting you. 1:30 p.m., the angel of death is visiting you. At sunset, he's visiting our homes and he's monitoring our activities. That's why the angel of death, when he takes our souls, he knows us very well. For some of us, when he takes our souls, he takes our souls with so much excitement. He is also yearning to meet us because he remembers for 50, 60 years, every time I visited this person, he was either being gentle with his family, he was either praying, reciting the Quran, he was working hard to make a lawful living for his family, respecting his parents. He remembers all those visits. And then for some of us, he despises to meet us, God forbid, because he remembers that every time he came to visit us, we were either listening to something that's haram, seeing something that's haram, saying something that's haram. He sees 60 years of a sinful life. And when that happens, the punishment becomes very severe. And he takes the soul in a very painful way. The Imam alayhi salam says, the most traumatizing moment for such people is the moment when their soul is separated from their body. Because they're so attached to their bodily desires, they can't function without this physical body. For them, it's very traumatizing and very difficult. But for the believers, you know what the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, says? He says, for the believer, for the true mu'min, the angel of death will come to him like an obedient, humble slave. He will stand by you like a slave. This angel of God will act as a servant for you. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, then he will give you the good news that you will be in paradise. Once the Prophet, peace be upon him, he went to visit one of his companions, one of the Ansar, as he was about to die. The Prophet, peace be upon him, saw the angel of death. He came to visit this man to take his soul. The Prophet, peace be upon him, told the angel of death, this man is one of my companions. He's a good companion. Please be gentle with him. You know what the angel of death told the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him? The angel of death said, Ya Rasulallah, trust me, I guarantee you that I will be more gentle with him than his own parents. That's how the angel of death will treat the believers, brothers and sisters. That's why we should not be afraid of death if we are prepared for it. So for certain people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dispatches the angel of death immediately without sending any angels. And then there are those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly takes their soul. You know who are they? One hadith in the book of Kamil al-Ziyarat, the Imam alayhi salam says, فَإِذَا بَرَزَتْ تِلْكَ الْعِصَابَةُ إِلَىٰ مَضَاجِعِهِمْ. It's speaking about the martyrs in Karbala. When it's time for them to leave and depart this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes it upon himself to take their souls directly without sending any angel, without sending the angel of death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take their soul. Once God takes their soul, the angels descend from the heavens and they will wash them with heavenly water. This is for the martyrs, the shaheed. This is the honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them. Because now they want to meet the king of the universe. When you have VIP status with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't need an aid, an assistant to take you to the king. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he himself will take their souls. The shuhada, those who are true shaheeds, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes their souls. And that is truly an honor for them, for the martyrs of Karbala, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them with such an honor. So there's no discrepancy. The angels take the souls of many people. The angel of death takes the souls. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the soul of certain individuals who have a special status with him, like the martyrs in Karbala. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes our souls, the barzakh officially starts. When the soul is separated from the body, the barzakh, which is a transitional period after we die until the day of judgment, it officially starts. Now what happens when the soul is separated from the body? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the soul. It goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the soul to go back to the body. So our soul goes back to the body and we have to stand or hover around the body. We cannot go any place far. And Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says that the soul is now observing everything that's happening to the body. You see what goes on around you. Those family members who have gathered around your body to mourn you. You hear everything. When you're being washed, when the shroud is being wrapped around you, you will witness and see all of this. When people are carrying you in your casket, in your funeral, the Prophet, peace be upon him, says the soul will hover over the body, witnessing everything that happens. So the soul has to keep within close proximity of the body moments after a person dies. One beautiful hadith says, you know what the soul will say? When you're being carried, when your body, when your casket is being carried, what does the soul say? In this hadith, the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, says, حَتَّى إِذَا حُمِلَ الْمَيِّتُ عَلَى نَعْشِهِ. the dead body is being carried in the funeral. رَفْرَفَ رُوحُهُ فَوْقَ النَّعْشِ. The soul will start hovering or fluttering over the body. And then what will it say? All of us will say this. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, وَيَقُولْ يَا أَهْلِي يَا وُلْدِي. My family, my children, لَا تَلْعَبَنَّ الدُّنْيَا بِكُمْ كَمَا لَعِبَتْ بِي. Don't let the world play with you and fool you like it fooled me. Don't let that happen to you. I made my income from halal and haram sources, and now others have inherited from me, but I'm the one who has to be held responsible. Don't let the world fool you. Don't let this be your fate. You spent your wealth not in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not worth it. Every soul will speak to those surrounding the body and say this. Is it really worth it? One day Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, he was walking in the outskirts of his city close to a mountain, when he saw another prophet of God who was a worshiper, who was in a cave worshiping God. He would come maybe once a week to the city to get something and go back to the cave. Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, he tells him, don't you have desires? He's like, yes, of course, I'm a human being. He's like, how do you control desires? How do you rein in your desires? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. How do you do that? What's your secret? He says, come with me, I'll show you what my secret is. He holds the hands of Prophet Dawood alayhi salam and he takes him to his cave. They go in the cave. He tells Prophet Dawood, you see that corner there? What do you see? Prophet Dawood looks. He sees there's a bed and there is the skeleton of a dead person lying on the bed. He tells him, I see the skeleton of a dead person. Then what? He's like, there's a sign over it. Read it. What does it say? He reads the sign and it says, I am King so-and-so. I ruled 1,000 villages and I had 1,000 women and I had all the wealth in this world, but this is my fate. I'm just a skeleton. It's like whenever I feel that the world is pulling me and my desires are pulling me, I just come to this cave and I look at the dead body of this king, at the skeleton of this king, and I tell myself, if this king who ruled 1,000 villages and he had all that power and wealth, this is his end. What about me? I don't have any of that. Why should I be fooled by the world? So the soul will speak to all those participating in the funeral and will say, don't let the world fool you like it fooled me. Have mercy on yourselves. And then this person is taken into the grave. When a person is taken into the grave, a new stage starts in one's journey to the Akhirah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create a temporary body, which looks like your original body, but it has different physical characteristics and features. It's much less dense, it's not visible to the naked eye. It has its own properties and features. This is referred to in the narrations of Ahlul Bayt as Al-Qalab Al-Mithali. It resembles your body, but it has different features. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the soul to go into this temporary body. Many people wonder, when someone, let's say, blows up, what happens to them? They don't have any body, right? Immediately when a person blows up and the soul is separated from the body, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates a what? A temporary body which will last till the day of judgment for most people. Then on the day of judgment, we go back to our original bodies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrects our original body which was fully decomposed. Or some people who, let's say, drown in the ocean, what happens to them? Someone asked the Imam alayhi salam, when someone dies on a cross, what happens to them? And they're kept on the cross for a month, let's say. The Imam alayhi salam says, Allah will dispatch an angel to take that soul, attach it to a temporary body, which resembles the original body, and then he takes it to the earth. So we are placed in this temporary body in our graves, and this is a new chapter, new stage. You know, the grave speaks to us every day, brothers and sisters. Every single day, the hadith says, the grave is speaking to us. It's addressing us. Do you know what it says? Every single day, the grave says, أَنَا بَيْتُ الْغُرْبَةِ أَنَا بَيْتُ الْوَحْشَةِ I am the house of loneliness. I am the house of solitude. أَنَا الْقَبْرِ I am the grave. أَنَا إِمَّا رَوْضَةٌ مِنْ رِيَاضِ الْجَنَّةِ أَوْ حُفْرَةٌ مِنْ حُفَرَ النِّيرَانِ I'm either a garden of paradise or one of the pits of fire. Every single day, the grave will address us and say this. Why do you think Al-Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam in Dua Abi Hamza al-Thamani, he cries for this? Because he's teaching us to be prepared, brothers and sisters. Prepare yourself for that moment. Because that loneliness is the most painful thing one can experience in the grave. أبكي لظلمة قبري أبكي لوحشة قبري The Imam says, I cry for the darkness in my grave. I cry for the loneliness of my grave. The solitude, the silence in the grave. Let's prepare ourselves for that, brothers and sisters. And then once we are placed in our grave, the interrogation starts. The questioning starts. Many of us have heard of the two angels, Nakir and Munkar, right? The hadith says, for the disbelievers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send Nakir and Munkar to interrogate them. And for the believers, Nakir and Munkar will not question them. The Imam alayhi salam says, Bashir wa Mubashir. Because you know what the meaning of Nakir and Munkar is? Munkar is something which is unpleasant. But for the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send pleasant angels, Bashir and Mubashir, two angels which will give you the good news of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for you. So they come to us in order to interrogate us. What do they ask us? Number one, as many of you know, they ask us, who is your Lord? We say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The believers will say, God. What's your religion? The believers say, Islam. What's your book? The believers will say, the Quran. Who's your prophet? The believers will say, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. And then we will be asked, who is your imam? Muslims today, will they be able to pass this or no? Who is the imam of your time who represents God? And you take your religion from him and through him. Who is the imam of your time? And then the angels will ask us how we spent our life on earth. How we made our income. How did we spend our income? One beautiful hadith says, every person, when they're in their grave, six images, six figures will come around him. One of them is the most beautiful image, the most fragrant, aromatic figure. One image is to the right, one's to the left, one's behind, because when a person is in their grave, they're on their side, on their right side. One's behind, one's from front, one is at the feet. That's five. And there's another figure that's hovering around the body. The hadith says, that beautiful figure, the most beautiful of them, will ask those other images, who are you and why are you here? The one to the right side of the dead body will say, I represent salah, prayer. I'm here because this person observed me, so I will protect him from the right side if anything happens to him. The one to the left says, I am zakat, I represent charity. I will protect him because he observed me. The one which is behind him will say, I am hajj and umrah. He observed me, so I'm here to protect him. The one in front of him will say, I am the fasting, as-siyam. The one at his feet will say, I am his good actions to his brothers in society. He helped so-and-so person. He was kind to that person. Allah has sent me to protect this person, to protect the soul, this body, from being attacked. And then you know what that sixth image would say? They will ask that beautiful image, then who are you? That image will say, I am the wilaya of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. And it will say to the other five images, don't worry. If there are any shortcomings, any problems, I'll take care of it. So the interrogation ends from these two angels. Once they ask this question, they tell him, okay, now we command you to write what you did in your life. Everything that you did. What do you remember? You remember. What you don't remember will remind you. The person in the grave will say, how am I going to write? They will tell him, use your finger as a pen. He's like, but I don't have ink. They tell him, use your saliva. Remember, now which body is going to write? Not the original dead body, but this temporary body which will be given to us, which is not visible to the eye. Then you will write with your finger, and the ink will be the saliva. The person will say to the angels, but I don't have paper. They will tell him, use your kafan, your coffin, and start writing. The hadith says that when you come across your good deeds, you're so happy and you write them quickly, feeling very proud of yourself. But then the hadith says there will be some moments where you'll stop. Your hands cannot write. The angels will tell you, what's wrong with you? You forgot? You're like, no, I didn't forget. They're like, then why don't you write? You will say, because I feel ashamed of writing what I did. You know what they will tell him? They'll tell him, in this life, when God was observing you, you weren't ashamed to do it. Now you're ashamed to write it? You have to write it. Write it! And they'll instruct us to write it. Now once that is over, respected brothers and sisters, once the interrogation is over, for the believers, Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam explains to us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will instruct the soul to go to Wadi Salam, this blessed place surrounding the city of Najaf. All of the souls of the believers, they will gather in that valley. They have a social life there. Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says, it's as if I can see them in circles having discussions. And when a newcomer comes, joins them, everyone rushes to greet that person and to ask about what's happening in this world, what's happening in this life. For example, one of the questions they will ask this new soul, this newcomer, they will ask him, so-and-so person, is he still dead or alive? If he says he's alive, so they will try to wait for that person. If he tells them that he has died, but they don't find him there, they'll realize that that person was doomed. They realize that that person was taken to hell because he's not to be found there. So it's a beautiful atmosphere there in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathers the souls of all the believers. And Allah creates a temporary paradise for the believers to enjoy themselves there till the day of judgment. And one hadith says some of the believers there actually have the honor to be with the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, every once in a while. To dine with the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. To be blessed by the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. And as for the unbelievers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will instruct their souls to go to a valley in Yemen called Wadi Barahut. They'll be punished in that valley till the day of judgment. Yes, is there punishment in Barzakh? Absolutely. The Holy Quran, what does it say? in speaking about Fir'aun, the evil Pharaoh, and his evil people. النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشيا. Every morning, every night, Allah will expose them to the fire. And then on the day of judgment, أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب. Then there's that permanent hell on the day of judgment. Now many people wonder, for those believers, do they have a chance to visit their relatives after they die? One person asked that Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. The Imam alayhi salam says, yes, Allah will give permission to the believing souls to visit their family, to visit their relatives. How often? The Imam says it depends on their status and faith. For those believing ones who have high faith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them permission to visit their relatives every single day. For some, every other day. For some, three times a week. And for those believers with a lower status, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow them to visit their families once a week on Friday. The hadith says when the believer visits his relatives and he sees them in a good state, worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doing good deeds, he becomes so happy. But God forbid when he sees them busy with the pleasures of this life, the temptations and the desires of this life, what will he say? When he sees them engaging in sinful actions, he will say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayhi." He will be sad and he'll go back. Remember that every Friday, at least, we're visited by those who have passed away. Let's make them happy, brothers and sisters, when they visit us. Let them see us worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not engaging in sinful actions, because that will hurt them. So this is the barzakh. It will continue till the day of judgment, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will instruct the angel Israfil to blow in the horn. Now the horn is not just, you know, a physical horn. One hadith describes the horn. It's made from light. It's as big as the universe. It has as many holes in it as there are souls in the universe. When the trumpet blows, every soul in the universe will die. All the angels, because of that blow, they will be drawn to the edges of the universe. That's how traumatizing it will be, even to the angels. وَالْمَلَكُ عَلَىٰ أَرْجَائِهَا. The angels of God, they will go to the outer surface of the universe because of the severity of that blow. Everyone dies except a few. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانِيَةً. Eight shall carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Narrations indicate that these eight will not die. Every soul in the universe, even Israfil himself, the one who blows in the trumpet will not die. Will die except these eight, they will not die. The Imam alayhi salam was asked, who are these eight? In one hadith, the Imam says, four from the early ones and four from the later ones. As for the four from the early ones, they are Ibrahim, Nuh, Musa, and Isa alayhim as-salam. And the four from the later ones are Muhammadun wa Aliyun wal Hasan wal Husayn. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Wa nufikha fi al-suri fasa'ika man fi al-samawati wal-ard. The Quran says, when the trumpet is blown, every soul will die in the universe, except for those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses. Illa man shaa Allah. And those are the prophets and the imams of Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. This is our journey, brothers and sisters. This is our journey from before we were created in this life and in this life, and this is what happens to the soul till the day of judgment. But Allah has given us a chance to have mercy on ourselves, to prepare ourselves for that moment, brothers and sisters. Because we learn from the martyrs of Karbala that if you are prepared for death, then death is sweeter than honey. Al-Qasim, the son of Al-Imam Al-Hasan alayhi salam, on the night of Ashura, he asks his uncle Hussein, "My dear uncle, tomorrow you informed your companions that tomorrow they shall die. They shall be martyred. My uncle Hussein, am I one of them?" The Imam wanted to test him. He tells him, "My dear beloved son, my nephew, how do you find death? كيف تجد طعم الموت? How do you find death? Tell me." You know what he says to him? He tells him, "My dear uncle, in your way, if I die in your way and protecting you, it is sweeter than honey." Imagine a 12, 13-year-old boy saying this to Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. When the Imam realized Al-Qasim was determined to become a shaheed, he told him, "Yes, my beloved Qasim, you shall also achieve martyrdom tomorrow on the day of Ashura." The day of Ashura comes. Al-Qasim is growing impatient. He sees the companions of the Imam alayhi salam one by one falling to the ground. And then he sees his cousin Ali ibn al-Akbar. He goes out to the battlefield and he is also martyred. He grows impatient seeing those beautiful youth of Bani Hashim falling one after the other. Al-Qasim walks up to his uncle, Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam, and he tells him, "My dear uncle, please give me the permission. I want to go and fight. I want to have the same fate as Ali ibn al-Akbar. I can no longer stand seeing you in this state." Because Al-Qasim, what broke his heart, he saw Al-Imam Al-Hussein standing by the tent, and the Imam was saying, "Why? غربتا وقلتنا صرا." The Imam is saying, "There's no one to defend us. Now I am lonely." Al-Qasim could not tolerate the scene. So he's begging his uncle Al-Hussein to give him permission. The Imam alayhi salam says, "How can I let you go? You are an amana. You are a trust in my hand. You are the nephew. You are my nephew. You are the son of my brother Hassan." And whenever we missed Al-Imam Al-Hassan alayhi salam, we would look at your beautiful face. "How can I let you go, O Al-Qasim?" But he keeps begging Al-Imam Al-Hussein. Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam tells him, "O Qasim, what about your mother? Has she given you permission? Go talk to your mother first." He tells him, "Oh, my uncle Hussein, just now I came from my mother. She's the one who commanded me now to come to you and to seek your permission to go and fight. I've already spoken to my mother." The hadith says the Imam alayhi salam, he hugs him, he kisses him. He kisses him. As he's embracing him, they both fall to the ground unconscious. Al-Imam Al-Hussein simply could not let go of him. The Imam tells him, "This is very difficult for me. I don't know what to do. I cannot give you permission. I can't see you die in front of me." Al-Qasim is now about to lose hope when he remembered that when he was 4 years old and his father Al-Imam Al-Hasan was passing away, he called onto him and he told him, "Oh my dear son Qasim, an important day awaits you when you grow up. Oh my dear Qasim, if one day you are feeling very distressed and you're losing hope, here is a letter from me. I have attached it in a piece of cloth," and he wrapped that around his arm. historical accounts say Al-Qasim remembered that. So he opened it, he saw it's a letter from his father addressed to Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. He takes the letter to his uncle Hussein. Al-Imam Al-Hussein looks at the letter. When he sees the handwriting of his brother Hassan, he could not hold back his tears. He breaks into tears. What does the letter say? Oh, my brother Hussein, on the day of Ashura, when you are lonely, when everyone has been killed, allow my son Qasim to go and defend you and become a shaheed. And Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam tells him, okay, my dear nephew, now I give you permission, and now you can go and fight those enemies. But the Imam tells him, first, I want you to go to the tents. Farewell your mother Ramla. Farewell your aunt Zainab alayhi salam. Al-Qasim is now excited. He's about to become a shaheed. So he goes to the tents of the woman in order to farewell them. The Arab poet, he captures the scene as he is farewelling Zainab alayhi salam, his mother Ramla, as he's farewelling Sukaina, because we have historical accounts that tell us Al-Qasim was about to get married. He was about to get married to Sukaina alayhi salam, the daughter of Al-Imam al-Hussein. So the poet, he captures this. He says, when Al-Qasim went into the tent, it's as if he is describing the scene. Lazmat rakab askana. He was about to marry her, but see, subhanallah, how he has the faith. He's walking from marriage, from life. لزمت ركاب سكيانا وعمت بحلقة شمة. He's farewelling Sukaina, he's farewelling his aunt. ومن الخيام مدهوشة طلعت تنادي أمه. And then his mother Ramla came. What does she tell him? يا ابني يا قاسم هالوكيت حالك لعمك ضمه. My dear son Qasim, I've prepared you for such a day. Save your energy to defend your uncle Hussein. لليوم أنا ذاخرتك مالك تخيب ظنوني. Don't disappoint me, O Qasim. Now what does he reply to his mother? أوصيك يما وصية. This is my will to you, O my mother Ramla. اتسمعين لفظ جوابي شبان لو شفتيهم بلد ذكر شبابي. My dear mother Ramla, if you ever see youth about to get married, then remember my lost youth, oh my dear mother. محروم من شم الهوايا من دون كل أصحابي عطشان أنا يا والدة حين الشرب ذكريني. And one more thing, oh my mother, whenever you drink water, please remember my thirst. He farewells his mother Ramla, he farewells his aunt Zainab, he farewells those women. Al-Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, he opens a box and he takes the turban of Al-Imam al-Hassan. He places the turban on his head and he tells him, now you may go and fight. He takes his sword, he mounts on the horse wearing the imama, the turban of his father Al-Imam al-Hassan. He goes out to the battlefield. إن تنكروني فأنا نجل الحسن. If anyone does not recognize me, I am the son of Al-Hassan. سبط النبي المصطفى والمؤتمن. You know who Hassan is? He's the grandson of the trustworthy prophet. هذا حسين كالأسير المرتهن. This is Hussein, taken like a captive, like a prisoner. بين أناس لا سقوص صوب المزن. Among a people who have no mercy, they're not showing him any mercy. Oh believers, he begins to fight very bravely until they surround him from every direction. Now one thing that happens is that the straddle of his sandal breaks. So Al-Qasim, he's now leaning down to fix his sandal. When one of those enemies, he takes a sword, he charges at him, and he strikes him on the head, dealing a fatal blow to him. Al-Qasim falls to the ground. As-salamu alayka ya amma. Peace be upon you, O my uncle. These are my final moments. Al-Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam rushes to him. He sees Al-Qasim dismembered, cut into pieces. The Imam is now very sorrowful. He tells him, O Qasim, ya'uzu wallahi ala ammik. أن تدعوه فلا يجيبك. Oh Qasim, it's very heavy on my heart that you call on me, but I cannot respond to you. Or if I respond to you, I cannot help you. May Allah curse those who killed you. بجو نادى يا قاسم شبيدي. What can I do for you? يا ريت الموت قبلك حزو ريدي. I wish I would not have seen this, O Qasim. Al-Imam al-Husayn, he lies on the ground. He places his chest on the chest of Al-Qasim. Then he takes his body back to the tents and he places his body by the body of Ali ibn al-Akbar. Now the Imam alayhi salam is overcome with tears. He looks to the right. He sees the dismembered body of his son Ali. And he looks to the left. He sees the dismembered body of his nephew Qasim. He begins to cry. The woman, they come out from the tent. Zainab is now coming out. She's crying. The woman, they come and cry. But there was one woman who remained back in the tent. She was embarrassed to cry in front of Al-Imam al-Husayn. That was his mother Ramla. She waited until Al-Imam al-Husayn left the scene. She came. She saw the dismembered body of Al-Qasim. She collapsed on the body. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا آلَ مُحَمَّدٍ أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. Brothers and sisters, wait just for a quick announcement before you leave. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.